Now, one problem is that sequence stratigraphy concepts sometimes can be a little hard to understand just by looking at paper examples or looking at 2D diagrams. Why? Well, the problem is, in sequence stratigraphy, we look at sediments in space and time, and the time component is very hard to represent in a 2D diagram. So the best way, I think, to approach these problems is to think in 4D, three-dimensional, and time added to it. But that's not easy to do. Luckily, we have tools to do this, and part of my research and what we do within my group is forward modeling. So forward modeling implies that you basically take a condition, initial condition, that can be a given basin with a given sediment supply, for instance, and then you give it rules, so the physical rules of how sediments will be spread and how much sediments are transported by rivers, and then you forward model this setting, this system, and you look in the end at the stacking pattern of those sediments. So that's what I propose we do right now in this class, to look at some simple concept in sequence stratigraphy. And the tool that we use in my group to do forward modeling is known as Dionysus Flow, and it's a software released by Basic Front Lab. Without going into too much detail in the software itself, what I should say is that the basic equation that we use, or set of equations that we use, are allowing for sediment to diffuse. So that means that we look at diffusion gradients, which are driven by topography. So if you have a high topography, sediments will diffuse towards the lower part of the basin. And of course, they're entrained by currents or by waves or by wind. So it's a relatively fast way to do modeling, and it is relatively accurate for basin scale modeling of sediment transport. So it's a very useful tool to look at mass balance, for instance, of sediments, and where sediments will end up and how their stacking pattern will be. So I did a very simple, very, very simplistic model for you. That simple model is effectively just considering a very simple ramp that has an incline of less than 1 degree. On here you have the impression that it's a deep incline because of the vertical exaggeration, but the model has dimension that are 80 kilometers long by 20 kilometers wide, so it's a very simple ramp. The number of cells in the model is 400, and each cell represents 2 kilometers by 2 kilometers. At the top of the model, I input sediments. It's 7 cubic kilometers of sediment per million year, and it's clastic sediment. 80% of it is sand, and 20% of it is clay, and that sediment comes from the top right of the model, so in the shallow part. The simulation time is 500,000 years, or 500,000 years. So now, let's look at how those sediments spread in the basin and how this simulation works. So you can see in blue here sea level, and you can see the first sediments starting to arrive. In yellow, you have the sand. In orange, you have silt and finer sediment. And in green, you have the clays. And you can clearly see that the sand follows sea level. So here we had a lowering of base level followed now by a transgression. And that model loops, so we'll see that model again. So again, look at how the sands accumulate close to sea level. See how the sands follow the position of the shoreline, which is normal because sands represent sifting by wave energy. And then we have a transgression. So that gives us an opportunity to look at the stacking pattern of those sediments. Now, a great feature of the digital tool is that you control everything. So I can actually use the model I just built and try to look at different aspects of these sediments. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to try to extract the lithostratigraphic units that have more than 70% sand, and then we'll plot the age to see if, yes or no, this lithostratigraphic unit is a chronostratigraphic unit. So here's our original model. Now we strip the clays, we have only the sand with 70% sand or more. And as you can see, it forms a nice sheet. So this is, you could call this a geobody. So we have an almost continuous sheet of sand throughout the whole basin. It can be thick, it can be thin, but this is all sand. But now, of course, we can plot the age of deposition of this sediment because we know it. This is a part of the model. Now, you see immediately that some are orange, yellow. These are the oldest sediments, and some are black. Those are the youngest sediment. So this sheet of sand, this lithostratigraphic unit, is not a time unit. It is not a chronostratigraphic unit. And this is really a great thing here that we can use a model to show this. And it is really a feature of these numerical models that you can show this type of behavior. And I think it's extremely useful as both a research tool, but also as a teaching tool. Now, one thing I've not mentioned yet is the fact that if you look at base level rise and fall, this happens at different magnitudes and at different time scales. So on this plot, you can see we have time on a vertical axis, and on the horizontal axis, we have distance. So that's the distance between the maximum transgression and the maximum regression. And the point I want to make is that you can decompose a natural curve into multiple segment of that curve or multiple component of that curve. And first you have in blue a long-term component. As you can see, it's a very simple rise of base level that gives you a transgression. Now, that long-term rise in base level, of course, it has the highest amplitude because you can see it's the maximum difference between regression and transgression. And it's known as a first order cycle. But superimposed on those first order cycles, we have shorter order cycles, second order cycles that I put in red here. And you can see that these second order cycles are more numerous. We have a higher frequency of second order cycles. So three in this case for one first order cycle. And of course, we can add on top of those second order cycles, third order cycles that are even more abundant than the second order cycles, and of course, which have a lower amplitude but a higher frequency. So that's really a feature here of base level change that is important to appreciate, is that it happens at different time scales and it can also happen at different length scale. And these curves, these first order, second order, third order, are not separate. They're actually component of a natural oscillation of sea level. So that's why it's actually complex when you look at the stratigraphic pattern. It's because you never know exactly what you are recording. So here's a way of representing these different orders as a hierarchy. At the very top, we have the first order cycles. They are high order, so they show high amplitude, but they're very low frequency. They only happen once or twice per, you know, hundreds of millions of years. So maybe you're looking at a Wilson cycle or something like this. Then second order are more frequent, but it's still low frequency. Third order are kind of in the middle. They're starting to get higher frequency. And then you can also have fourth and fifth order. Nobody has ever recorded or it's very rare to find mention of sixth order cycles. Now, part of the problem I have with this ordering pyramid is that there's a sense that the order represents a certain time scale. The issue is it's very hard to constrain time. And when you look at the magnitude of those cycles in meters, you can be tempted to think that a thick sequence represents a first order and a thin sequence represents a fourth or maybe even fifth order. The problem, of course, it all depends on how much sediment has been accumulated and, of course, also on how much sediment has been preserved. So applying this notion of orders of cycle is actually very tricky, and that's why I'm actually cautioning you against this practice. Right, so now you have the basis for sequence stratigraphy. In the next lecture, we will explore in greater detail system tracts.